This is not our normal set.
It's Thursday, 3:30, isn't it?
I got a little scared. I looked over my shoulder and I saw like a giant U sitting there, man. I'll tell you what, we are so excited to be in Charlotte, North Carolina. This is Auto Dealer Live. It's not Thursday. It's Monday, September 8th. It's 1 o'clock. We're live, remote, airing from the Unfair Advantage Automotive Mastermind Group. Spring in about, I mean, a room full of dealers and automotive professionals, man.
Yeah, we've got about 100 people here, you know. Typically, our show is where the dealers go, but we kind of switched that around this week. Right. We came to the dealers.
Absolutely. The show where the dealers go. We're excited to come to you. Do I have the Eminem playing in my ear? We're excited to be here, and we've got a great show today, man. It's going to be a little longer, and we've got some outstanding guests. But before we do, we want to announce something that's going on. On Twitter, follow us at Auto Dealer Live. Make sure you use the hashtag UAAMG, and that way we can track it here, and we can tell you what's going on. And we've got, listen, I don't think that he's seen his face in like 7 years.
No, he hasn't. I think that'll be more of a shock. More than the crowd, it'll actually be himself that's more shocked.
Absolutely. So we've got JD, you got to turn that music off my ear. We've got JD, the car guy. Did I get that right?
JB
the car guy. And he's bearded. And you're gonna see him on Twitter. He's bearded. He literally looks like you haven't seen your face. Your wife hasn't seen your face. That's his brand. He's gonna shave his beard off today. Now listen, it's not about Auto Dealer Live. We're actually doing something pretty cool. Glenn Posh is a sponsor and told us about an awesome charity, the Children's Tumor Foundation, or CTF.org. And Cribs and I are going to donate $100. I've seen some other guys, Craig Locker, different people said they want to get involved. And here's the bet. Subi Ghosh is afraid of clowns. I mean, she's with Dealer Authority. And Dave, so if Ronald McDonald, Subi, walked in the room right now.
I'd punch him.
She's afraid of clowns. So yeah. Arnold,
that's a very common fear. You know, I didn't really know that not long ago. That's a very common fear. I guess that happens in childhood.
Like
clown.
Get
scared by the clown. Yes, I don't
know. Yeah, there's like clownophobia. So she is sitting there next to Arnold the clown. The deal is JB shaves his beard if Subi makes it through the show sitting next to Arnold the clown. So you got to cheer him on. We're going to document it. We're going to bring up JB at the end so you can see his clean face.
I did not see this one coming for the show.
I just want to say something about this group, man. It's amazing. We've been here. We came a little early. We got to check out the bonus sessions with Elise Kephart and Robert Wiseman. Just incredible content. Unbelievable. And what a family.
Yes, this place is so unique. I mean, dealers, you owe it to yourself to check out the Unfair Advantage Automotive Mastermind Group.
That's twice you got it right.
It's just the neatest thing, you know. We're in an environment where dealers are getting to express what's going on at their dealership. What do they see working? What do they see that they need help with? And everybody's coming together as a team to benefit one another.
Yeah, it's unbelievable. And you know, we've been to conferences and there aren't any speakers per se here, and it's amazing because, you know, you sit in a room for 4 or 5 hours. I do. My ADD kicks in overdrive and I'm asleep. Well, I haven't even lost interest in this group, and this morning it's just been amazing. Troy and Tracy, great at moderating. And I want to tell you this, guys, dealers, I don't know how much space you have, and obviously it's an application process, but dealers, if you're interested only, from what I understand, in moving the needle and making a difference not only in your dealership, but in others around in this room, then I would suggest you get a hold of these guys and find out what's going on, because it's an amazing setting. So, amazing folks.
And it's exclusive to dealers. And you know, if you're in a market, you have to apply to be in this group. They vet the members very heavily, okay, but there's no cost involved in being in the group. And it's early. I mean, we're basically at the anniversary of the first year. This is a type of group that, you know, 3, 4, 5 years from now, it's going to be coveted. You won't be able to get in, possibly.
Absolutely. So check it out, and make sure you, again, follow us on Twitter at AutoDealer Live and hashtag UAAMG so you can know what's going on, and watch Jeremy as his beard falls off his face hair by hair. And, so we're excited to see that. We're excited. He's going to donate to Locks of Love, I think. I don't think they use that kind of hair, man. It's too coarse. Well, we're ready to kind of jump into the show. I'm excited. We have some outstanding guests today. Really quick, man. We're going to close the show. I'm going to mention... I'm going to mention the closer first. We're bringing on the one and only Grant Cardone. He's going to close the show out. So I don't know what you can expect. I don't think anybody does. But I can expect greatness. That's one thing.
You'll never be disappointed. That's for sure.
Who else we have?
We've got Dave Anderson,
CEO.
President CEO, Learn to Lead. I mean, if you're in the business, you know who Dave Anderson is. As a matter of fact, I would just want to mention this before he comes on the show because, you know, during this morning's mastermind session, his name came up several times, and it wasn't even in reference to him being a guest on the show. This is a man...
It's a reference to leadership.
Yeah, this is a man who's poured into the car business, that car dealers are modeling them, so they're listening to him, and it's working.
Absolutely. And one of my exciting... I mean, one of the things that we do on our show, at least once a quarter, we have what we call a Great American Automotive Panel. Here's the deal. I mean, I love to hear from vendors, and I know these dealers feel the same way. We have some incredible ones in this room. But when you get a dealer that takes the time out of their busy schedule to jump on and talk about their dealership, I think that's priceless. And we've got four dealer principals. We have Lisa Copeland, the number one Fiat dealer in the United States of America. The last time she was on our show, she had Fiat North America in Detroit watching the show. She literally had them all. With the TV on.
Executives at Chrysler tuning into the show. How cool is that?
CEO of our Vice President Lasco Ford, Matt Lasco, a good friend of mine, great dealer. He does about 380 to 400 new and used a month. But he took the store over for his dad when they were doing $150. And Matt is lighting up. We also have Paul McCarthy, Paul McCarthy. He's actually not too far in Jacksonville, North Carolina, and he is the executive general manager of the Stevenson Automotive Group. He's going to be with us. And then we have Marsh Vice.
Yep, he is a general manager. And you know what's cool about that automotive panel? They're handpicked. They are dealers who are hugely successful. We handpick them from around the country. It's an honor to have them here.
Absolutely, we're excited. So without further ado, we're going to bring on our first guest. Dave Anderson, absolutely no stranger to the people in this room, is president of Dave Anderson's Learn to Lead. He's an international sales and leadership company expert, just a phenomenal guy, best-selling author. He's got amazing books. One of my favorite is If You Don't Make Waves, You'll Drown. I haven't heard too many people talk about that one, but it'll bust your chops. And Dave has enjoyed an extensive career in the automotive retail industry. I'm so honored to have him. I know that Tracy and Troy are as well. Dave Anderson, thank you for being with us. How are you doing, sir?
I'm doing great. How are you all?
We are outstanding. Guys, let's hear it for Dave Anderson.
Yeah. Yeah.
We're so happy to have you on board today. You know, we were talking earlier in the conference about the fact that I believe last month, August, was one of the biggest August since, I believe, 06. So we're in, you know, a lot of times we look back and we say, hey, man, remember when this, remember when that? That was the heyday. Well, I think we might be in the heyday now. And while business is flourishing, I want you to express, Dave, what are some of the things that we need to be paying attention to as we go through this?
Well, as business is flourishing, it's a wonderful thing when that happens, but we have to remember that as prosperity rises, urgency diminishes, urgency goes away, and so does intensity, and so does accountability normally. And so, you know, we don't want to wait for something bad to happen, a downturn, to start holding people accountable again, and to start training and recruiting and doing all those disciplines we know that are essential to getting us where we're at. What often happens in good times, people start to lose their hunger, guys, and they're no longer playing to win, they start playing not to lose, and they get into this maintenance mode, and they never fully leverage their opportunities. So you just simply have got to watch out marketplace and see and stay hungry, and that's something we can talk about a little bit here today if you want.
That would be wonderful, Dave. And you know, we have one of your we have a lot of giveaways today from you and your company, and we have one of your red belts up here that you've signed, and it's a martial arts belt. Would you share with our dealers kind of what that means to you?
You bet. I learned, and I wrote an article about this a number of years ago. I learned about the red belt mentality in the martial arts, and just to give you a brief history, I think you'll find it ties very well into business. My first day or so into the martial arts studio, the instructor pointed to a wall, and there were 12 belts on the wall, from white to black, all the way, you know, running the gamut to become a black belt. And he pointed to the red belt, which is the belt that looks like this, the one just like you have, and he said, this was the belt actually right next to black. And he said, do you see that red belt? I said, yes. He said, let me tell you something. He said, the red belts are the most dangerous fighters in the studio or anywhere else you're likely to go. Well, I was a little confused by that because I'm looking at the black belt and I'm thinking, well, isn't that the objective, to at least become, you know, a first degree black? And so I asked him, and he said, let me tell you, he said, we have some fantastic black belts. He said, but what often happens is when somebody passes their black belt test, they construct that they've arrived. He said, even though there are 10 degrees and many, many more years worth of study, he said, the number one thing most black belts do when they pass their test is they start putting on weight because they're not training as hard. He said, sometimes they pass the test, haven't seen them again for months. And when they do come in, they're really not training hard. They're kind of walking around with their thumbs in their belt loops like they're Jackie Chan giving advice to everybody. He said, but the red belts, he said, they're still hungry. And they know they haven't arrived, and they're humble, and they're teachable. And they don't try to borrow credibility from what they did once upon a time. And they come in and they prove themselves over again every single day. He said, I have seen more hungry red belts knocked down or knocked out complacent black belts. He said, here's what you need to remember. He said, if you ever become a black belt, continue to think like a red. He said, act like a challenger, even if you're the champ. He said, challengers are hungry, they're humble, they have something to prove. Champs can get cocky, complacent, and start to lose their edge. And so as he's telling me this, guys, I get the point with the martial arts, but I'm thinking in business is the same thing. We see people in business, they get their version of their black belt. Number one in their area, best month ever, number one in CSI, number one in whatever. And the same thing can start to happen. Complacency can start to set in. In fact, only 10% of first degree black belts want to get their second degree. As many years as it took them to get to that point, it's just proof again that what gets you here won't necessarily get you there. They lose something, the intensity, the reasons, the skill level. And so we have to continue to have that red belt mindset. I gave a speech in Detroit one time. They had 900 dealers there for four, and they gave them one. I did our red belt signing, 900 red belts at the end of the session, so they could bring the red belt back and put it on their desk or put it on a bookshelf and let that serve as a visual reminder, you haven't arrived. There's work to do. Yesterday ended last night. You've got to come in and prove it again every single day. Stay humble. Stay teachable. Stay in training. Come in and make it happen. And so I think it's a very healthy mindset, gang, especially right now when, you know, you're looking at big increases in some lines or even more than others. I mean, I was talking to a group of Chrysler dealers in New York for the weekend, and they were up 18 or 20% last month. They're particularly susceptible with those types of increases to lose some of that intensity and to become complacent.
Dave, I want to jump in and ask you this, because in this group, and it's a private group, and a lot of the discussions and so forth are private, but one of the questions that was asked and some of the dialogue that's going on, a major pain point is how to hire, who to hire. And Craig Lager actually has submitted a question that I want for you, and I want to throw this at you. He said, fire them before you hire them. And he asked, would you explain the why of that process?
Absolutely, and that's a wonderful question, and I've written probably as much about hiring as anything else, entire chapters and entire books on it. The objective of an interview is to eliminate the candidate, not to include the candidate. You've got to protect your culture. You need to have a structure where you have pre-structured character-based questions and competence-based questions. You've got to determine both of those things. One doesn't substitute for the other. Most people have no interview structure. They go in like it's a casual conversation, like it's a good old boy getting acquaintance session, or heaven forbid, they turn it into a sales pitch, and they lower the bar so the wrong candidate can get over it. You've got to protect the culture, team morale, your momentum, and your brand. So first, you've got to have a plan. You've got to go in with your interview questions, with your structure, and with the objective to eliminate the candidate. If most of us do the opposite, we go in with the objective to find a way to include them. Well, if we lower the bar here, or we make an exception there, then maybe we can plug him in someplace. You know, he's better than nothing. He has coverage at least. And that is already compromising, and you're already making excuses for someone. And that's the wrong way to do it. If you hire the wrong person, you're going to pay for that over and over and over again. So if you get in your mindset to where there's a lot at stake here, there's a lot at stake in the interview, the customer experience, the employee experience, our brand, our results. And so I've got to take this very seriously. It's not enough just to like the person. There's a big difference between interview performance and job performance. I've got to have a plan to figure out, can they do the work? And I'm going to try to eliminate them. And if I can't eliminate them, then the chance is they're going to be a pretty darn good candidate. And if I bring them into the right culture, I can really develop them and help them flourish. But you know, hiring ultimately should be an elimination process. And you can see how most leaders do it wrong, because their rosters are filled with mediocre people. Many of them do it just enough to get by, just enough to get paid, just enough not to get fired. And it's not that they don't train them very often. It's not that they're not even holding them accountable. It's that they hired the wrong person to begin with. And normally, they let themselves get desperate. And now they're backed into the corner, and as desperation rises, standards fall, and then you make even worse decisions. And so you've got to have a hiring strategy. You've got to know where to recruit, how to recruit, how to interview, and you've got to have the right mindset. There's a lot involved, but it's worth every minute you spend learning about it, because everything else you do in that leadership is going to be dependent on did you hire the right person to begin with.
And Dave, are you always looking for that person? Are you waiting for when it's time to hire, or are you always scouting out?
Well, if you're waiting, it's too late. See, that's the problem in the good times, especially. We get complacent, and we don't build a pipeline. You know, I've written a lot about recruiting, and the key to recruiting is you've got to build a pipeline of talented people before you necessarily need them. And I know that's hard work. And I know that takes time, but it also takes time to wind up the wrong ones every day because you didn't do what I'm suggesting. Just remember, as desperation rises, standards fall. That's a principle in hiring. That's actually a principle in dating. Some of you know that. It's a principle in a lot of different areas. The more desperate you get, stuff that ordinarily would not have been acceptable.
That's my wife.
To compromise.
My wife did that. She got desperate and finally married me, so I'm with her. I got a question though, Dave. You said something a second ago about that. You said that if they're waiting, it's too late. And you said, I know that's hard. And you addressed that. And I want to kind of maybe ask you to expound upon that a little bit. I know it's hard. Well, is that the main reason that somebody, a dealer or someone hiring maybe a sales team or personnel, is that the main reason that they do not recruit in advance because it's hard, or are there other reasons?
Well, it's hard work and it takes time, and they have, of course, bigger fish to fry. There's the emergency of the moment they've got to handle. So if I've got enough staff, why would I go out and recruit? Why should I go collect names? Why should I build a recruiting database? It astonishes me, most leaderships do not have a recruiting database where they put in names and contact information of great people they have found and send them out regular communications to keep them in the loop, to kind of let them know what's going on and to keep them in the pipeline. That's a little bit of work, and so they don't do that. Instead, they end up doing the harder work of trying to get the wrong people to do the right thing, firing them, and then hiring somebody else and going through the same nonsense. It's hard work either way. I can't tell you that recruiting is easy, and you can't have all your eggs in one basket, like the one app. You have to have multiple streams working for you simultaneously over time. No one strategy is going to bring you in a flood of eagles. And in fact, the eagles aren't reading the one ad, so if that's your strategy, you're going to already be doomed to bringing the bottom 30% of reporters, which is what studies show the one ads bring in. Now that's inspiring, isn't it? If that's your primary strategy, you get to talk to the bottom 30%. So even if you get the best of what comes in, you get the best of the worst. And that's really not a great way to build a tremendous team. And so if you ask most organizations, what is your recruiting strategy? You get the deer caught in the headlights, but they don't have one. And they certainly don't have one to recruit candidates that are already working. Who are the best candidates? The people who are already successful, happy, productive. I call them passive job candidates. People, they love every excuse. Well, there's a shortage of talented people in my area. But you've got to stop that loser's lift. There's no shortage of talented people in your area. I don't care what area you're in. The creator didn't get ticked off in your area and stop putting talented people there. What you have to understand is the most talented, effective, productive people are already working in and outside of the industry. What is your strategy to attract them? Most people have zero. What about your culture would attract them that would make them want to come to that culture because they could grow and they could make a difference? Most people can't even articulate that very well. So it's a wonderful place to focus, gang. The problem is when times are good, people really aren't doing it. And they're focusing, you know, that recruiting is probably very low on the strategy priority list right now because complacency has taken hold.
Dave, I wish that you could see everyone in the room because dealers are intensely listening. They're writing down and taking notes. They're nodding their heads. And we're almost out of time, so I'm going to wrap it up with one final question. I'm going to ask you if you could give the dealers here one or two nuggets that they can take back and implement when it comes to precautions as far as not missing anything during these flourishing times.
Well, yes, here's a test to see if you've gotten complacent. And please keep in mind, complacency is poorly defined. It does not mean you're lazy. If you look it up in the dictionary, it means you're calmly content and smugly self-satisfied, which is exactly what happens when you get successful. So it's very important to understand what I'm talking about when I talk about complacency and how to overcome it. People say, well, if my managers aren't complacent, they work 80 hours a week. That doesn't mean that they're not complacent. You can work 80 hours a week and still be so calmly content with your results that you're not holding people accountable, that you're not training them. And so complacency is not about the hours you put in as much as it is what you put in the hours. So here's a test that everybody should take if they're willing to look in the mirror, and this could be a takeaway for them. If you want to do the test to see if you've gotten complacent, list everybody on your team and go through them one at a time and ask yourself this question. Knowing what I now know about them, about this one, Fred, Bob, whatever their name is, if they applied for the job today, would I hire them? And if the answer is yes, terrific, go on to the next name. If the answer is no, knowing what I now know about them, are you kidding me? There's no way I would rehire them. Obviously, that's a sign of complacency. If you've got somebody working for you that you wouldn't rehire if you had the chance to do it all again, you've gotten complacent. If you've got people on your team right now that you would not have had on the payroll back in 2009, during the depths of the recession, you have absolutely gotten complacent. Now, it's not about fault, it's about fixing it. And so if you wouldn't rehire somebody, you've got three options. You train them, you transfer them, or you terminate them. And you look at them in that order. The first T is, have I done my job? Have I trained them? If not, for goodness sakes, do your job. There's no sense in throwing people away, bringing in new people, and then subjecting them to the same abuse. You say, well, no, he's been trained to death. Okay, then you look at a transfer, but you have to be careful. Don't transfer someone with a bad attitude. They'll just poison the next department you put them in. But if it's a talent issue, they're just not good at this particular job, then a transfer can work really well. Stop trying to fix the person, fix the casting error, get them in the right seat. But if that's not an option, then you're down to the third T, which is to terminate. There isn't a fourth T that's tolerated. You've got to remove the dead weight. And so that's a takeaway. Go back as we start to get close to this fourth quarter and evaluate your team honestly, realistically, and deal with it. Jack Welch said, look reality dead in the eye and act upon it with as much speed as you possibly can. Because let me suggest one last thing to you. If you have dead weight, leaders, if you have dead weight on your team right now, and most of you do, I'm going to guess, most of you do. I speak 120 times a year and I see it everywhere I go, all right? Most of you do. And you don't do anything about it, then you're the dead weight. Just so you know. I do my trips like this everywhere I go, you
see. But it's true.
What could be greater evidence of dead weight than someone who realizes they have it and won't act on it? And so you've got to go and remove the dead weight. Try to transfer it or terminate it. The second takeaway is if you want to hold people more accountable in this fourth quarter, you got to redefine what you expect. Go back and redefine expectations in every department, not just the monthly forecast, but the daily activities to create the monthly forecast. We don't have enough accountability on a daily basis. We have month-end accountability. We need daily accountability to where we outline these are the non-negotiable activities you've got to nail every single day that will make that monthly forecast attainable. And identify those, put them in writing, share them with the team. Now you've got a benchmark for accountability. Otherwise, the question is, accountable for what? You will drastically strengthen your culture. If you go back and redefine what you expect to finish this year strong, make it clear, get out of the gray area, and then hold people accountable for those activities.
Man, well said, Dave Anderson. I appreciate it. And we have to go, and I want to thank you for being with us. But before we do, if you can just tell, for those that don't know, tell us where they can find you and how they can get in touch with your company.
You can find us on at the Learn to Lead website, learntolead.com. All of our articles are there. Our workshop information is there. And on Twitter as well. My Twitter address is DaveAnderson100, the number 100. And I posted a 5 or 6 minute video today just with this in mind. The 5 key reasons leaders don't hold people accountable. I thought it would help those of you who want to follow up after this meeting. And it makes a great meeting for your managers. There are 5 key reasons. It's a 5 or 6 minute video. It's at my DaveAnderson100 Twitter account. And you can watch that today. I send out daily tips. Get on our website. You'll find all you need about us there. And keep that red belt mindset game as this year winds down. The speed of the leader is the speed of the pack. If you let up a little, they're going to let up a lot. You catch cold, they're going to get pneumonia. That's how it works. You've got to bring it and set the example every day.
Well said. Let's give Dave Anderson a hand, guys. Hey, real quick, guys, we're going to give away Dave's red belt. So let's, before we, as we're getting the dealer panel on, they're not going to be Skype because there's so many of them. So we're going to get them on audio. Why don't we do this? If we can just hashtag UAAMG, everybody that has a Twitter account, come take a picture of Jeremy's hideous middle shaved beard. Now you look like pork chops kind of deal going down there.
I don't know.
That's like a reverse
Amish. Tracy's looking like you know his next wrestling promotion.
Come on, everybody take a picture. Here's what we're going to do. How about this? The most retweets. Tag everybody with the UAAMG hashtag. Everyone in the picture. You can do 10. Everyone tag 10 people you know. Whoever gets the most retweets gets a red belt. How about that? Huh? Very cool. That's red belt kind of stuff. All right. We're going to jump right in as you guys are doing that. We're going to jump right in. This is so exciting. It's the Great American Automotive Panel. And we have, they're talking right now, but we have Matt Lasko. He is the Vice President and Dealer Principal of Lasko Ford, Marsh Vice, General Sales Manager of Mark Chrysler Dodge Jeep in Lafayette, Louisiana. We have Lisa Copeland.
Lisa Copeland, number one Fiat dealer in the country.
She's out of Austin, Texas.
Yes.
Fiat of Austin. And then we have Paul McCarthy. Paul, everyone thought the Beatles were going to be on, so we did that on purpose so we would just absolutely blow up the social media thing. But he's Paul McCarthy, and he's the Executive General Manager of the Stevenson Automotive Group. He runs 7 dealerships in Jacksonville, North Carolina. Panel, are you all 4 with us?
Hey guys, how are you?
Good afternoon.
I love that one. Yeah, it's
great to speak with y'all.
Man, it's great to have you guys.
So much.
We've got time here, so we're going to jump right into the first question. What we did, guys, and we're going to just kind of point the questions, and then the format would be, you know, you guys comment on them. I mean, you know, if you hear this question, don't feel like that you have to wait until your question. Comment, give your answer. It would be great to have each of you weigh in on every question or as many as possible. But one of the first questions that came in was, we're talking a lot here about process, and I think it's a word that people like and that, but yet don't like. And here's the question. How do you get your team bought into new process? Matt Lasko, I'm going to start with you. How do you get your team bought in on new process?
Well, I tell you, one of our big factors is we feel like that every process we have set up has to allow any new person or anyone shifted from the department to be able to walk in and take place without having to ask the previous guy what to do. So we don't let anyone run to the floor as a salesperson until they've mastered a process. We don't let a manager or a salesperson become a manager until they've mastered a process. And we're committed from the top down. My brother and I could both go out and do every single process in the store. And if he and I jumped in to do a sale or desk a deal, we'd never skip a single step of the process. Because I feel like the second you show anybody that the process can be, you know, circumvented, then you're going to have that create, you know, more problems in the future. So we really, the commitment to it, and then we've also documented every process we have, whether it's the cycle from an internet lead from the beginning to the very end, or the road to the sale. Every process in our company is typed, documented, and every employee can look and read at it any time they need to.
I agree, guys. I mean, the success of any dealership is people and processes, and, you know, us too. I mean, everything we do is documented. You know, we have a book of processes when you're selling a car or if you're washing a car. It doesn't matter. I have a certain way that I want it done every single time. I think consistency is key for success.
Well, what do you know about success, Lisa? Are you an expert on success? I think so. The number one Fiat store in the country. You know what? I want to kind of ask you to kind of expound on that, because not only are you successful, but you're successful with a brand when it wasn't successful and you were challenged in a unique way. And you're also in what has been in the past consistently a man's world, so to speak, and you're busted. And so, I mean, how do you get process, how do you get your team to buy into process, Lisa?
You know, it is negotiable. You know, you want to work for us and you want to work for me if you're going to do it my way. And our way, the Fiat of Austin way, because we know that these processes that are in place have made us, you know, the number one Fiat retailer of all time. You know, we're really proud of that record, but we have to prove the same way every single time, and everyone's got to be bought in on that, or we won't be successful. So there are people out there that, you know, they don't want to follow the processes, so I help them find their next job.
Marsh, what do you think about that, Marsh?
Yeah, I mean, I just finished an interesting book called Grinding It Out, and it was written by Ray Kroc. And, you know, Mr. Process himself, the founder of McDonald's. And, you know, there's no question that, you know, we can go in the backyard, probably most of us did yesterday, grill a hamburger. We can all make a better hamburger than McDonald's. But McDonald's, you know, his biggest thing when he first started out was to make sure that the consistency in the process was uniform no matter where you travel in the United States, no matter which McDonald's that you went to. And it's the same thing with our dealership. We have to make sure that we're consistent in all that we do. And a lot of times with new salespeople, they don't know exactly, you know, why they're doing it. But what we have to do is we have to be a hands-on approach in being able to show them. So what we do is we always put them with the senior salesperson. And then we're hands-on the entire time. Like Lisa said, it's non-negotiable. And the more that you stay with that, the more consistent result that you'll have as well.
Thank you, Marsh. Thank you. And Paul, this question is going to go to you. And this is actually one of our dealers here at the conference that had proposed this question. We have a dealer that's been in business for many years, and he is doing about 50 cars a month, but he needs to double that. He needs to go to 100 cars a month. So what do you suggest if you're in maybe a smaller town or you've been at that same number for a while, what are some of the things that maybe you need to first take a look at when trying to increase your volume as a dealer?
David, I apologize. I'm having a hard time hearing you, and I couldn't understand the question.
I apologize, Paul. I'm gonna ask it again, and it's a pretty general question. But as far as a dealership that is in a small rural area and has been in business for many years, and this is a franchise dealer, a new car franchise dealer, who's averaging around 50 cars a month, and he really needs to go to 100 cars a month. He wants to double that production. What are some of the key things he needs to be looking at for expansion?
Well, if I'm understanding the question, is there a dealer that's trying to find a next level business? Yes, sir. I think, you know, one of the things we do, of course, the first thing is, you know, is working your existing data and, you know, using those customers to find other customers or to upgrade their vehicle. Certainly, you know, direct message, getting the word out there. You know, you can have the best team in the world, but if they don't have customers in front of them, you know, to use the processes that, you know, Matt and Lisa talked about, then, you know, it doesn't matter how good they are. So we have to be able to draw traffic into the showroom, or at least to surface it on the internet, in order to continue to grow.
Matt, you want to jump in on that?
Well, yeah, I want to get my little bit of feedback, David. I'd have to say is his town might be small and rural, but he's got to really look at the circle around him and see if there's some dealers around there that are delivering the volume of cars that he's looking for, and try to find out where he's missing that opportunity. Then he'll be able to target off where he's going to go after for mail or a radio or whatever it may be. But, you know, our dealership, a prime example, this store sold about 40 new and 40 used a month for 20 years. And it's in a town that now has grown up to a whopping 11,000 people here in Benton. And we crank out 400 cars a month now. Now, years and years and years ago, no one would believe that's possible. But we were able to sit down and look and devise a genuine plan. So if he wants to sell 50 more cars, is he going to do it by selling 10 more subprimes, 10 more new, 10 more cheap cars, 10 more repeat and referrals, but get some type of a plan to get to the 50 so that you can actually teach it off in little seconds. And that's how we grew our store, literally. Every time we wanted to go up 50 more units, we said, okay, we can do 10 more new fusions by doing this. We can do 10 more subprime by marketing here. And we teach it so that it wasn't just a big number. It was five small numbers to go after every month.
Right, and actually, I think the other part to that too is because I love that, and you know, there's lots of buckets when it comes to selling cars and being successful. But you know, I really like guerrilla marketing, which is I think one of the big successes of the out of office, and I have always called it taking it to the street. And I think that just is another bucket, you know, where you know, you have got to take your cars and your products and your people to the street, and you take them to events, you take them to everywhere. For the first 3 years, we were everywhere. There wasn't a football game. There wasn't a meeting. There wasn't anything that we were not in attendance with people and cars. And, you know, and because a lot of times I told my people, you know, even what we sell, it's what we stand for. So if we can go out to the streets, make those relationships, show our car, because a lot of times they're not going to come to us. We're going to build a relationship, and then therefore, you know, we're going to sell cars. So that's just another bucket.
And that's coming from the number one Fiat dealer in the nation. That's great advice. And I'm going to switch it up a little bit. I'm going to ask Marsh if you'll answer this question. But when it, you know, one of the buzzes is self-branding here, and I wanted to ask you, when it comes to self-branding at your dealership for individual salespeople, what does that look like, and what would you say to dealers who are maybe apprehensive about allowing an individual salesperson to self-brand? Are there boundaries? What should that look like? Can you expand upon that?
Well, I think the brand, you know, you don't heard me say before, but, you know, somebody comes in and buys a Jeep Grand Cherokee from me, you know, I cost $45,000. I just throw in the Grand Cherokee for free. And, you know, people are buying, you know, the individual, they're buying the salesperson. And I think as you know, it's a different dynamic than when I sold. And so, you know, before people came to the dealership to get information, and now they have the information. Now what it's up to us, to dissect that information and fit it into their world. And so I think now more than ever is so important, and it's so free for each salesperson to take the initiative, and also management to help support it, and create some different platforms. I know Robert Wiseman, you know, I love him, and I love what he's created. And you know, he was kind of one of those pioneers that did it when he was on the floor. And so, you know, I still show the guys what he did, and we still talk about those kind of different things. But it's important that as sales managers, just because we didn't do it, doesn't mean it doesn't need to be done. So the way we sold cars is different. Today, what we have to do is embrace that with our team, and then help figure it out. There's so many different platforms, again, that's free, and it's just a matter of consistently getting out there and consistently promoting your name.
And, well, hey, Mark, just a quick thing there. Well, wouldn't you agree that we actually did all do that 20 and 30 years ago? That almost everybody in that room can raise their hand and remember one salesperson that sold 50 Cadillacs a month or 50 Fords a month. Well, that guy did. He had hooks, he paid referrals, he dropped business cards, he sponsored his own ads in the paper, etc. That's all we're doing now, is we're giving our guys a new avenue to do that. And I agree with you, and we've used the Wiseman as examples there, but our entire staff is committed to whatever it may be, that Facebook page, Twitter page, their own email marketing that they do to their newsletters to their people. And we've learned to embrace it. They're not wasting time on Facebook when once a day you see a source on your ad tracking sheet say Facebook and it's a referral or Instagram. I've got a kid that somehow figured out how to sell 5 cars a month on Instagram because he's got so many followers. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of avenues out there.
It's great.
And people always want to print in carpet. That's what we always overlook. People are terrified of our business. And so the quicker they can latch on to somebody who is quote unquote a friend in the business, I mean, it spreads like wildfire from there. And I mean, it's so easily used or should be used, but it's not. So just to throw something out there too, David, there is for those sales managers, there's a great, it's an old article by Tom Peters, and it's called The Brand Is You. And it's a great article. It's something that would be great to go over the meetings. And it's one of those evergreen articles that, although it's probably a decade old, it's still very, very relevant in understanding how important your personal brand is.
Yeah. Well, I
agree 100%. We actually have it in our sales meeting room. You know, isn't what you sell is what you stand for. And so, you know, that's what I tell my people. You know, cars are a commodity. They're going to buy a Kia, they're going to buy a Hyundai. It's like, they're not really that much into the car. They're into you. And so you have to put your best face, your best plan, everything best forward, and to everyone's point, and create your brand. And when I hire, I ask them, I say, what is your social reach? Because that is your best marketing avenue. That's how all of us know, Twitter, right? Twitter, Facebook, whatever. And so what is your social reach, and what is your, you know, how are you going to go out there and inspire people and tell people what you're going to do that doesn't cost any money? So.
Absolutely. I have a question that kind of goes along with it too. I mean, looking at some of the renegades, we have one here, Elise Kett Barton and Laura Madison, and some of these that are out there that are just really beginning to send out video and really brand themselves. And I guess I want to ask this because most of you guys are dealers on the panel. Why are dealerships, and I know that they experienced this early on, but then there were some challenges that were overcome. Why are they so intimidated by this? I think that's a good question, because if they want to grow their business, I mean, is it the fact that they don't know how to do this? They don't understand it? Because, I mean, I think that, personally, I think that not everybody has some of the out-of-the-box thinking that's needed, but then hire someone who does. But why is there that intimidation factor? So, there. I'll ask you, Matt.
I think
there's
still a fear. I think
if
you look at, you know, people who are whatever. I think it's the fear of the unknown. And so I think that it's crucial that the dealers bring in the young people that really understand social media ads and all of that. So I think a lot of dealers don't engage because they don't know how to, nor even know who's bringing in to do it.
Matt, now you're there?
I'm here, guys. I'm sorry, I couldn't hear the beginning. I heard the last bit there, but I had a breakup. What were you asking? I'm sorry.
It's okay, Matt. We were talking about individual salespeople self-branding. You know, what would you say to dealers that are a little bit afraid of that when they say, you know, hey, I don't know if I want to relinquish all this power?
Well, my younger brother is our protector of our name and brand, and it literally takes, so every dealer can hear it, if you have a franchise and you have a name, it takes 2 seconds to send an email and cease and desist anybody that has a Facebook or a Twitter that has anything to do with your company. We've had, you know, salespeople come and go, and they built Bobby at Lasco for you, Carter.com Facebook page, and part of our process of parting ways is then to have to either release rights or cancel the page. And you're talking about a dealer that's really, really socially branded, and we're big within our market, we're on the dealer raters and everything else. I, to this day, and we've been into it for 7 years plus doing branding salespeople, have never had a rogue employee or a bad scenario where all of a sudden someone put bad things on the web about us or something that had these pages. So if that helps comfort any of those dealers, I can assure you that you'll get way more plus out of it than negative. And if you buy into some of the things that are out there, to give you the idea of the reach, our dealership does some weekly and monthly little giveaways and some things to like and share and comment on our page. In the past 6 weeks, we've added 5,200 people to just our last before Facebook page. That fast. So today, David, did you get my picture I sent you of our super sale?
I did.
All right, so the 5,200 people plus another 15,000 people plus all of our friends all got to see what we were doing with one picture in 1 minute. And there's no marketing avenue in the world that can do that fast for you.
Well said.
Wow.
All right. Marcy, you weigh in on that? I mean, just on the fact of branding. I mean, I know you don't own a dealership, but I mean, just speaking from the fact that you're around the circuits and you see things that are going on, why is there such an intimidation factor when it's so necessary in today's world? So dealers, I guess let me ask it this way, dealers would rather not do it than to, you know, than to venture out sometimes and do the unknown. Why?
Well, I think it goes back to the good old boy network that our industry is keeps falling into that rut. Where, you know, what we have to be able to do now is we've got to challenge everything. We've got to challenge new ideas, new processes, and new ways of thinking. And you know, again, just because you don't understand it doesn't mean it's not relevant. And I think, you know, when I get younger employees in here, they're teaching me. Of course, my kids are teaching me all kind of different stuff. And I don't refute that. I want to know what they're looking at, because they're going to be the future buyers. Those guys that are on the floor, those are the ones, they're going to be the buyers. And they're marketing for buyers just like them. So I want to know what makes them think. And we have to, as leaders, we have to embrace those kind of different things. It starts with embracing it, encouraging it,
And, you know, then if it's like Matt said, they're protected. But if there's, it may be the fear of it, of boundaries getting crossed, or sounds like, are way worse than the actuality. It's very, very rare. We haven't had an instance either.
Well, let me ask you this.
You know, we're always looking for that millennial buyer, and we're looking for that female buyer. And those seem to be the two hot buttons when I go speak to dealers around the country. How do we get the young ones, and how do we get the women? I said, you get online, and you talk to them the way that they want to be talked to. You sell to them the way they want to be sold to. And it's all online. It's all on social. I love it when your salesman sold five cars a month on Instagram. That's how this millennial and female buyer, that's how they communicate. And so we have to communicate and sell cars to them the way, you know, up to with the media that they're looking at, and with a lot of the traditional stuff we've done in the past, because we're not getting the eyeballs that we need to get.
I want to ask this question. We got about 4 minutes, so I'm going to let each of you answer this just in a short answer. A lot has been talked about hiring and how to hire. And just we'll start with you, Lisa, then we'll go Paul, then Marsh, and then Matt, you close it. And how do you hire? Your last two, three best people, whatever position, how are you hiring these people? Where are you looking? How are you attracting them? Lisa?
So, I'm sorry, how
are
you hiring? So, can you ask me to go first?
Yes, if you will.
Okay, great. You know, I'm every single person that works in my dealership. Everybody I have a story with, you know, whether they sold me clothes or they were a great bartender or whatever. So, I mean, I'm very intentional, very seldom running an ad, because I don't want somebody looking for a job. I wanted to find somebody looking for a career. So I'm very intentional on who I hire, and so it works out great typically. And this is why we've got such a high retention rate.
And Paul, I'm gonna ask you to answer that question as well, if you can hear us.
Well, I think, and Lisa mentioned this earlier, but I think that the person needs, you know, social links, their involvement in, whether it's community activities, a Facebook, a digital presence, those things are extremely important because, you know, and certainly, you know, how the person demonstrate themselves interpersonally, because that's how that person's going to talk to your customers. So I think that, you know, how involved they are, how outgoing they are, they're good factors for us.
Absolutely. Marsh, give me your last, your best last two individuals. How'd you find them?
Well, for us, there's two avenues. Number one, we use automatic, we use them for the last three or four campaigns, about every 3 months. We're bringing them in, so we're committed to that. And then the other aspect is we're always recruiting as well. We talk about this in staff meetings. Who did you come across? Who kind of caught your eye? Because we're always looking at food servers and bartenders and all those kind of different people. So you know, we're always the trick to it is don't wait until you have a price and then all of a sudden you start trying to hire. You should be recruiting and hiring the entire time and talking it up and talking it amongst managers at all times.
Yeah, and Matt, you want to weigh in on that and then talk about the show?
Yeah, I got two things that we've had some great success with. Number one, we do a referral program to our current staff. Anytime anybody gets hired and is in our company for 6 months, that there's a referral that someone that works here brought in, we give them a $500 referral fee to have that person get 6 months. And part of the reason that is the best way to get people to survive is if they have a friend within the building to help them survive the first 3 to 6 months in the business. And then I'll tell you our most important thing, we started years ago back when the first BEC hit a dealership, but we basically had Lasco Food Ford University. If you get hired in here as a low entry quarter oil change diesel or anything else down the line, we discuss with you the opportunity to grow and whether you have the desire to grow. And we continually are training those people with the opportunity. I literally have two quarters right now that are out of that program. They put their 6 months into detail and 6 months into BDC, and now they're 6 months into sales, and they're 15 star salespeople that learned our process our way. And I think that all those dealerships out there probably have tons of low entry positions that we're only hiring to fill the position instead of hiring to grow the person. And that's been a huge success for us to grow internally and take an office person that becomes a BDC person and becomes a finance person. That's how we get these 10 to 12 years of full BDC. A big help for us.
Well, guys, we want to thank you for being with us. I appreciate it. I know you're all four very busy, and what a dive. Well, let's give them a hand, guys. Let's give them start winding into the close of the show. Really doesn't need too much of an introduction at all, but I'm going to give him one. Grant Cardone is an international business and sales expert. He's authored 4 business books and customized sales training programs. I love this Cardone On Demand, which is here in Dealer Solutions Magazine. We're talking about this article, and right now just launched the Whatever It Takes Nation, WITNation.com. It is literally taking the social fear, I guess that's the worst thing. Basically online by storm. I want to thank Grant Cardone for being with us. Grant, highly anticipated. How are you, sir?
Hey, Gus. Thanks a lot for having me. Appreciate it.
We appreciate you. I'm going to jump right in, man, and we're just going to let you kind of just do your thing. But a question that came up here, and it kind of goes along with the article that you wrote, Finding, Keeping, and Motivating Great People. It seems to be the topic so far today. And the question that came in from a gentleman in the room is, Grant, the one thing you look for in a new hire?
Well, the thing I'm looking for, let me just show you what I'm looking for every day, all right? Forget about the people for a second. I just got this from the Internal Revenue Service today. this is what I got to police. And if you're a business, you're running a division, a department, you're running a whole company, or you're running 200 car dealerships, you gotta be clear on why you're there every day. And I'm there to take care of my family, my business, my employees. And I've been listening to your show, everything from Dave Anderson to your panelists, talking about people and business and the opportunities and social. But the reality is, when you boil a business down, sooner or later, folks, this is what you're going to work for every day. You're going to have to fill out some forms. You're going to have to pay Uncle Sam. Hopefully, you're making a ton of money. Nobody watching this is making enough money. How many agree you're not making enough money?
Woo! Yeah. And by the way, let's give it up for Grant Cardone.
And I'm giving money, baby. I'm giving money. There's 7 billion people on this planet, and I'm going to keep hunting for them until I find the ones that want to work, that want to hunt. These young people might know about social media, but do they know how to show up on time? Did anybody teach them how to push, how to shove, how to get uncomfortable? Most of them have been taught not to talk to strangers. I mean, if you're a parent, you probably taught your kid, don't talk to strangers. That's the kind of problems you're dealing with today. You're talking to kids, they're scared to go outside and talk to anybody. They know how to sit in the chair, they know how to memorize. And this is a problem not just for car dealers. The car dealer that thinks, if you think your problem is unique, you're wrong. Because I work with companies from mom and pop companies that sell muffins to companies that sell motorcycles, to boats, to jewelry, all the way to Google. The problem is the same for everybody. How do I find great people? How do I make the people I have better? How do I take the average people up a notch? How do I motivate people when the reality is your people are getting dumped on every day? Every day they're getting dumped on. They're not money motivated. Here's some facts that you want to write down that are affecting your company right now. 76% of all Americans in the wealthiest country on planet Earth. God bless America. 76% of us are living paycheck to paycheck. That's your people. That's who you're hiring today. These people start thinking it's all right to live paycheck to paycheck. That's a problem for you because their buddies, their friends, their mommy and their daddy are saying it's all right to live paycheck to paycheck. How many of you want to make more money? Selling cars, we sell wheels, we sell washers, whatever. Hell, I want to make some more money. Whether you're selling books or programs or social media or you're selling an automobile or jewelry or muffins, the reality is I need people that are highly motivated every day. And you have no chance, zero chance of having highly motivated people, of finding them or keeping them motivated if you're not doing something to motivate them. That means you need to immerse your people in some kind of content. Right now, they're getting banged by 800 TV channels. The average American spends 4 hours between TV, radio, Stitcher, Audible, Fox TV, MSNBC, Watching Joan Rivers' funeral this weekend, where, and I love Joan, but you know what? It doesn't help me to watch a funeral. I need to make me some money, baby. Who wants to make some more money? Woo! Woo! Here's some facts for you. 87% of all salespeople miss their sales quota. How can anybody be motivated when 87% of your sales staff is missing their quota? Now, I want to ask you a big question. If your manufacturer today, tonight, when you got home, removed incentives and quit buying 580s, what would happen to your business overnight?
Wow.
It'd get destroyed, okay? It'd get destroyed. The only vertical in America that has been improved, that has improved back to where it was in 2009, and I heard Dave Anderson, which I love Dave, okay? I love Dave. And Dave was talking about, go back to thinking about what it was like in 2008, 2009. The only vertical that's gotten close to improving back to where it was is the automotive. And it's because of pent-up demand, and because the manufacturer is basically buying paper of people that shouldn't be able to rent a car. Come on, how many of you were surprised this weekend when somebody got a brick? You're like, oh my God. That wasn't a deal for you, dude. That wasn't a deal. That's not a deal. You did anything to get, to keep, to make. You didn't get that deal. If it wasn't for Toyota buying that paper, you wouldn't have that deal on your books. And that window is going to close again. Now, I'm telling you all that because there's a couple ways to be motivated. One, you get motivated because you're trying to get someplace, or you're motivated because you're scared shitless. I don't know about you, but I'm scared, baby. I'm scared. I know the American economy is in no better shape today than it was 5 or 6 years ago. We're $17 trillion in debt. You got an American consumer that doesn't have any money, okay? The FICO score, the 580 FICO score on buying a home is off 90% from where it was. 46% of all the homes bought in the first quarter of 2014 in the United States of America were bought with cash. Those are investors, okay? The housing vertical hasn't improved. Why? Because their consumer doesn't have the money to go out and buy a home. They put more pressure on that FICO score so that buyer can't buy. But in automotive, we're like, oh, whatever, he's a 580, put him in a car. No money down, put him in a car. Just stretch it out to 96 months. Hell, we'll make it 108 if we need to. See, my point is this. You're missing sales quotas, and things are great. 48% of all salespeople follow up. 52% never make the first follow-up call. That is a disaster. Why? Because nobody's making them make the call. How do you motivate people? You make them do something. So first I want to look for motivated people. There's 7 billion people. If you think all the good people are gone, you're wrong. You gotta believe there's some good people out there, okay? Change your thinking. Let everybody else think there's nobody good left and start thinking, hey, I'm gonna find that one or two or three or four good people left in my marketplace. Yeah, most of them aren't any good. Most of them are contaminated. Most of them are watching bad TV. Most of them are watching reality, or they're watching our Facebook posts. Find the ones that are hungry. Find the ones that are motivated. And then keep them hungry, keep them motivated. And make them do what they don't want to do.
That's good stuff, Grant. Dick Cripps here. You know, we're here in a group of dealers, and obviously after... But when this conference ends, I think I speak for everyone, all these dealers will go back with these ideas. They're going to be taking on new challenges, implementing new things that they've learned here at the conference into their dealership. But what would you say to that dealer who's apprehensive about shaking it up too much? Like, where do you find that balance of motivating people, you know, coming back on fire, but getting them bought in without being over the top?
Yeah, I mean, I'm probably the wrong guy if you're looking at that. I mean, I'm just the wrong person to get advice from. I mean, I think you need to go listen to Dr. Oz or Dr. Phil or, you know, maybe go listen to the President of the United States. I'm not looking for, you know, shit, dude, I'm scared. When you're scared and your obligation is to take care of your family and you're no longer satisfied, and Dave was talking about complacency. Americans are complacent. Okay, I'm not talking about your people right now. I'm talking about you. You are complacent if you're not pushing your people. If you're looking for balance, you will not find exceptionalism. You will not find, you will not become a resource. You will be a commodity-driven business and never become a resource if you're looking for balance. I want extraordinary people. I want extraordinary profits. I want to make more money. I make it clear. Look, 80% of what I do is for free. On Facebook, Twitter, we beat those mechanisms to death. I use them. They don't use me. I don't watch social media not to use it. I'm using it. I'm consuming it. I'm not looking for balance. I'm looking to expand my profits, expand my brand, to get into more marketplaces, to beat YouTube and Twitter up, to beat Facebook up. Look, I like to beat things up. So I'm not the right guy for everybody because I'm a fanatic. I'm all in. I'm an all in guy. If you watch any TV at all, watch 13 Hours of Benghazi. I think it's called Benghazi 13 Hours.
Yeah.
Most amazing TV I've seen in 5 years. Okay. Talk about people. You think those cats are looking for balance? Baby, when you're getting mortars dropped on you, rocket launchers at you, there's fireworks around you, you're not looking for balance, you're looking for survival. You're looking to do whatever it takes, in order to make sure that your month is big, not just barely getting by.
Well, I got something to ask you, Grant. I think your comment on this, but okay, the car business, you've been around it for a while, and I've been around it for almost 20 years now. Why do towns and people not want to work at dealerships? In other words, it's a business in the industry. You just said that's one of the few industries that are making a significant comeback and rocking. But why do people leave the car business to go and pursue other things? I've heard you talk.
Because car dealers treat people like shit. You know, I mean, come on, let's just keep it with, you know, not all of them. Bernie Marino treats his people great. He texted me the other day. Bernie said, hey, what can I do for my people this month to get them really excited? Lisa Copeland takes great care of people. But no offense, but the industry just doesn't think about taking care of people. And this isn't just an automotive problem, okay? Go work at McDonald's and the people there complain about not being taken care of. The difference is somebody in the automobile business can make a lot of money, and there's tremendous upside. I think we do a poor job of telling people about the upside in the business, and it's got a bit of a tainted, you know, I'm a car salesman. Nobody goes to college to be a car salesman, I'm sure you guys have discussed this, The people that don't leave the car business, I think the question to ask is who doesn't leave? The people that don't leave are the ones that are making money though. I didn't plan on staying in the car business. I went in the car business, I said, this is good for 1 or 2 years. You got 7 years out of me. You got 5 more years out of me than you should have. And the reason why is because I was making money. I couldn't go make some other place. Now, here we are in 2014. Margins are shrinking. Compressions are tight. The good news is the average customer is only shopping 1.3 stores. I mean, they're coming. They're somewhere between 57% and 70% sold by the time they're contacting you right now. Okay? 70% sold by the time they get there because of the 11 hours they spend on the internet. It's never been easier to close a customer. But you got to have your people trained, you have to have them motivated, you have to have them ready because that customer at least thinks they know what they're talking about. So I think we keep the business a secret. I think you need to go out there and tell people about the chance to make it. Median income in this country is $48,000 a year. What's the chances of the guy making $60,000 a year in the car business today? Or 70, or 80, or 120, or literally getting out of the middle class and hitting a $128. That's all it takes to get out of the middle class today. $128,000, boom. And you are by all standards said to be in the upper elite of earners in the United States. Not to mention the finance managers and general managers that are in that $200,000 bracket and $350 or $500, where you're in the top 1% of all the earners on the planet, not just in the U.S. So I don't think we do a good job in this industry of telling that story.
And great points, Grant. And, you know, I know that you have a great team there. What would you say to dealers that maybe have a few people on their staff selling cars, but they're not effective, but they're afraid to get rid of them because it's just going to leave them short-handed? How would you deal with? Would you rather be understaffed, or what would you think about that?
Yeah. Oh yeah, absolutely. I would absolutely be rather understaffed. Okay, because the truth is, You got a couple of marginal people there that are just filling up. They're basically there, but not there. They've already quit. A guy told me the other day he got fired. He called into one of our shows, and he says, "I got fired." I said, "Yeah, but when'd you quit?" And he's like, "Oh, they let me go yesterday." I said, "Yeah, but when'd you quit?" And he's like, "No, man, you didn't hear me right." I said, "Oh, no, dude, I heard you right, okay? When did you quit? Okay? You quit before they let you go, man." He says, "I quit about a year ago." I said, "Good. They made it official yesterday." You know, you should have had the guts to make it official a year ago. And the reality is that guy has been like what appeared to be a cog in a wheel that wasn't. It was a loose nut. So, you know, the best thing you can do, and I think I heard Lisa say this, is let go of people, man. Just make it official. Let them go. There's too many people employed in this country right now. Unemployment's not a problem in this country. Employing people that shouldn't be employed is a problem. And so I would ask fewer people to do more and always be looking for great people. And I wouldn't listen to your manufacturer that says that turnover is a problem. You must have turnover. If you don't have turnover, Joan Rivers said, she turned her management team over every 3 to 4 years because they started to take her for granted. Turn them over, man. Look, you're operating out of scarcity, like, I can't find anyone else. Sure you can, you're just not looking. So look for great people, acknowledge them that they're great, spend time, energy, and money on it. You cannot overpay a great person. It is impossible to overpay great people, whether they're GMs, sales managers, desk managers, closers. Pay people and pay them good. Pay them so much they don't want to leave you. And then expect them to deliver 10 times that.
Well, we got a question here from the audience, Grant. I know we only have a few minutes, and I appreciate you being with us, man. This is from Glenn Posh, and he actually...
Who wants to make more money? Woo! Being broke, man. Shit, I can't live like this anymore. I'm tired of worrying about the bill. Don't you? When you guys go to dinner, ladies and gentlemen, when you go to dinner and you see the bill's $1,300, you're like, oh, my God. Don't you hate that?
Yes. This you're gonna love this question. This is seriously a question that came in, but this is very, very good. He said, this is from Glenn Posh. He said, "What is the best way for dealers to implement your training?" I didn't write it.
The best way is to shove it into every orifice that they have. Okay, it's not a choice. I don't look for dealers that want to swim in the Kool-Aid. I look for dealers that want to drink it, eat it. You know, like, I just want to be dropped completely into it all the time, like, submerged, immersed, die in it. That's, and every trainer's going to tell you the same thing. Look, immerse your people in it. Any trainer that doesn't tell you that it needs to be a complete immersion, he or she's not even sold on their own product, okay? For training to work, the reason it fails is because you don't do it enough, period. So, like, we did a test with a group. We put two groups, one that was trained, training was an option, and the other training was forced. There was no buy-in. They were required, this group was required to do 6 segments of content a day. It could be on any topic. I don't know if they can see this back here. It could be for new hires, greeting, phones, objections. We didn't care what the topic was. Anything, motivation, handling objections, handling phone calls, appointments that didn't show, whatever. Follow up, first call, second call, third call. All this is laid out in very short videos. So this one group, we forced them to watch. The other group, we didn't. They both sold exactly the same product in very similar markets. And the difference in the two groups was $1 million in profits in one 30-day period of time. One, it was optional. The other group had to watch 6 3-minute segments a day, 18 minutes. It's worth $1 million of net profit. Not gross profit, net profit. That was 6 segments, 18. All 50 people had to, were forced to, required to, mandatory. Couldn't take a phone call or wait on another. Would you do that? Would you force your people? Would you be willing to lose people to make another $1 million? Because the reality is, folks, if you don't make another $1 million, you're going to lose them sooner or later. As soon as the manufacturer stops your incentives, can't afford them anymore, as soon as rates start blipping up, as soon as we find out that we might have an automotive lending bubble creating in the United States, if they stop that, you get hurt. And who's going to get hurt is everybody that's not training, not educating, not forcing your people. The average salesperson's never read a sales book. 60% of all salespeople in America admit that they have no playbook, no plan at all when they meet a customer. 87% of all salespeople miss their quota. 52% of all salespeople never make a follow-up call. Why? Because they don't know what to say. And when I don't know what to say, I'm not going to be motivated.
Well, Grant, well, you know, we're just so happy and honored to have you with us today. I know we're going to wrap it up, but before we do, in appreciation for you being here.
Who wants to make more money?
Come on. In appreciation for you being here, will you tell us a little bit more about what Grant Cardone has going on right now? I know you have you've launched a new network and some other things. Will you share with us some of those things and how to reach you?
Well, you know, thank you for asking. Now I can promote myself. look, you know, let me just say this. If your brand is what you do every day, it's not how you feel every day. I saw on Twitter this morning, this guy says, you know, your brand is your emotions. I'm like, no, dude, your brand is what you do every day. What are you doing every day? Every person that works at your company has a brand. Everybody has a brand. The first 25 years I was on this planet, my brand was a question mark. I didn't know what I was. Today, you probably know me as a promoter, somebody that will promote his books. You might know me as an author. You might know me as a guy that does radio shows, or I do automotive training, or maybe you know that I work with the U.S. Army or Google, or that I'm creating all these radio channels and TV thing, and I'm doing this digital network. The reality is, you probably also know me as somebody that has a lot of work ethic. And so your brand, I really ask each of you, before I get into what we're doing right now, look at what is your brand? What do people know you as? You know, do they even know that you're in the car business? You know, half your people, nobody even knows they're in the car business. They're not even telling anybody. So who do people know you for? Right now, you might know that I'm an author. I've written 4 books since the economic collapse. I'm working on my 5th book right now. It's called Obsessed. I think David, those guys have a 10X rule in front of you. We provide people with information however they want to use it. Like, our best-selling products are not books, they're audio downloads. So a guy can download a program onto a phone and have me with him all the time. We've created this digital platform called Whatever It Takes Nation. I was actually encouraged by Joan Rivers 3 years ago to create my own network and not go sell my shows to the Turnaround King, if any of you remember that, on Nat Geo. She's like, you shouldn't sell it to the networks. You should own the show, do it yourself. The networks will steal everything, they'll own everything, and they'll move too slow. So I basically, the last couple of years now, I've been working on this thing called WhateverItTakesNation.com. It's a digital network where we stream content to people so that you don't have to watch MSNBC, CNN, CNBC, ABC, CBS. You get to watch what you want when you want it, but it comes with no ads. It says you have a restless leg syndrome or some kind of erection dysfunction, or that you're somehow demotivated or depressed. Everything is about your success, your business, your future, and keeping you in this mindset to do whatever it takes. Whatever it takes. It's the 3 best words any spouse can hear from their husband, any wife can hear from their husband, is whatever it takes. And that's what we're working on right now.
Well, man, Grant, let's give Grant a hand, guys. Come on. We just been honored. We appreciate it. And thank you. Thanks, Grant. Thank you, Grant. That was Grant Cardone. The show's gonna be wrapping up in about 10 minutes. We're gonna have JD here is gonna finish shaving his beard off. We have one short segment that we've implemented a few months ago. Some of you guys know who they are. This is gonna wrap the show up. This 10-minute segment. But we have a little intro here. This is Amanda and Aaron Ryan. The Ryan sisters are up in Canada. Are you from Canada, right?
Yeah.
You know these girls are? They this is a get your social on segment. So Mike, go ahead and roll the intro and enjoy.
Today's awesome topic just happened to be, there is no secret sauce in social media. There's no secret sauce, right? Everybody thinks that there's some type of formula. It's not like baking a cake or when you're trying to, you know, build a cake. There's no instructions. There isn't. And what you're trying to do when you bake a cake or build a table is to come up with the same result. You won't get the same result for every single page because just like each dealership, every single Facebook page or Twitter account is unique. There are guidelines, but there's no secret sauce. That's right. There isn't. So you have to pay attention to your page. So you have to make sure that you are being different, you're standing out, because you sell different cars, you have different personalities looking at your dealership, as well as you're a different brand. You know, the different makes and models that you have, everything is different. So everything is going to be different, and it should be. Right? That's something you should be celebrating. With that said, even if you are in your competitor's area that you guys sell the same makes and models, same location, you still have an opportunity to use social media and it'll be completely different than your competitors. It's not like SEO. You don't have to worry about that 50-mile radius. So jump on board. Definitely. I mean, you're worried about your competition. It's something you don't need to worry about when it comes to social media. Show your personality, showcase what you are like on the inside of that brick and mortar, online. Right, and just because it's no secret sauce and there's no formula, instructions, or recipes, doesn't mean you don't have to have a strategy. You definitely have to have a strategy. Know who you're targeting, know what it is that you want to share, and you want to make sure that you build strong relationships with your customers, your local customers. Exactly, you want to retain them, you want to create new ones. That's what we're all about. That's what we're wanting to do, is create relationships so people trust you and want to buy into what you're selling. That's what it's all about. So let your customers help you. Yes. They can either, when you're telling your story through content, whether it's video, images, text, when you're telling your story, do they like it? Are they satisfied with it? And how do they sell? Well, basically, they look at the engagement, right? Social actions. What is happening? What social actions are happening on your page or on your website or on your blog? And if it's not like, they will definitely find you too by not doing anything. If they're not doing anything, then you're putting out the wrong content and you need to revise your strategy. So there's no formula, there is a strategy, that's right. And who helps you? Your customer. So here's an example. We have a 2014 Hyundai Equinox Centennial, and people liked it. Let's say they liked it. They loved it. They loved it on that. They liked it up. What do you do? What do you do there? Like, it's not a one-hit wonder. It's not. You can use images, other images that you can use in your best set before.
Like blog posts.
Yeah, articles. And text posts. Ask questions.
Yeah.
Ask about its history. You don't have to just stick with pictures. Go outside the box. Become creative. Be the observer on your own page. When you post the content, watch it. Pay attention. And listen to what your customers are telling you. Because those likes and shares and comments mean something. They mean that your customers like or want to share, or feel like they want to talk about what it is you're focused. If it's not there, change the content. Change the conversation.
Change the conversation.
This is not the end of the film. It's not. I think it might be a relative. I think they might be talking. We didn't get 100% confirmation on that, but yes, it's kind of busy. But this is your potential customer. What do they like? What don't they like? It's up to you to find it, because that's how you then target your market.
Right.
You want to target the right people, the right demographic, the right age group. Then you want to target your location. So, here's an example. If you're in Detroit and you're a Ford dealer, you already have two things you want to add to your strategy. You want to target locally, and you want to target Detroit, and you want to target your Mason model, or it could be North Carolina. It's clear. But basically, you want to look at your local area, and you know, there's so many great things in your local area that you would know about. Share that experience. You know, share the coolest pizza place or the historical information that goes along with that. There might be some of you scratching your heads right now saying, well, what does the pizza place have to do with my doorstep? You share the same location. And if you share the same location, that's commonality. And commonality is what brings people together. If you like the same TV shows, you're going to talk together and become friends. That's how people connect. And so, because the similarity is your local area, that gets the conversation started. And then you'll get people who love Ford, and then you'll get Ford, both the local and Ford lovers. And that's the local community and audience that you want on your social network. Your customers play a key role. Their voice certainly matters today. They might have years ago, and they should have always mattered. But even more so with their online influence that they can provide not only to their friends and family members, but complete strangers.
That's true.
So what they have to say, what they like, what they share, what they comment on, really goes far further than you think. And I heard you guys talk about social media earlier, and I was like, yes. We had needed on that other panel. It was awesome. Because social media plays a huge role in today's age. You've got to get on board. You've got to play the game. But remember, there's no secret sauce. There's just strategy. Play to your dealership. Play to your strengths and play to your personality. To if you take anything away from this specific episode of Get Your Social On today, is that there is no secret sauce. However, if there was, it would be your customer. That's right. So that's something you definitely want to keep in mind. Be the rockstar that you are. Hello, my name is Rockstar. That's exactly what you want to do, is utilize your social network towards the people that you actually could have coming inside your dealership. So let's play towards those customers.
I don't know what comes to you.
Bring them to you. It is time for Get Your Social On. Hope you're doing it. Come on, you guys are moving around. Okay, so today's social shout out goes to @Laura@Marie. These are people you can follow that are in the automotive industry that are wonderful, and you can interact with them and share your like-minded. Yeah. Follow them on Twitter. Connect with me. We're talking about home loaning. @Dano_NCG.
Dano.
What's going on? You're great to tweet with.
Yep.
@SellMoreCars101. Great to fix there. @GBH8. And @SheermanWorth. You guys are all awesome. Yeah. You guys can be up here. Actually, get your social on. Tweet out at we are Ryan. And make sure you include the hashtag Get Your Social On. And for this special edition, also include the hashtag UAAMG and hashtag Cardone in your life.
Always.
If you like us as much as we like you, we really like you, give us a clear. You should come and join us at our Facebook group. And the reason why we have a group over a page is because we want your voice to count, and that means you can chat with us, post. Nobody needs to approve it. You just be your awesome self, and we can interact together. That's facebook.com/getyoursocialon and become a GYSO addict. You know you're
the only addiction you will never want to be cured from.
No, you're not sincere. not at all. All righty. That concludes this week's Get Your Social On. I know, this is so awesome, but we're in your mind right now.
It's
so exciting. I'm so glad to see all your awesome faces. You want to know where we're from? We're from the internet marketing company Wikimotive. And if you want to learn more about internet marketing in general to help provide more resources for your dealership, check out wikimotiveblog.com today.
Or tomorrow.
Or right now.
Yeah, get out your phone.
Until next week, friends. Get your social on.
Thank you, ladies. Thank you.
Thanks,
ladies. Thank you, guys. Let's give it up for the ladies from Canada. We want to thank Tracy and Troy. We want to thank you guys for letting us do our thing here. Everything on this table, we didn't know how to really ring it in, but we're going to give it all away. We got two autographed books from Grant. If you want to figure out a way to do it, whatever you guys want to do. And we just want to thank you guys for giving us a chance to...
Yeah.
I'm sorry, man. Hold on a second. But listen, really quick. Actually, I knew there was something. We had 4 minutes. We didn't tell Suvi, but Suvi, I think it's only appropriate that you kiss the clown on the cheek. Come on, let's hear it. You want to kiss the clown on the cheek? No? No such thing? Come around here, man. Sit down. Look at this guy.
Look at who's this guy?
Hey!
Who is that guy?
Very cool. Let's give it up for him. Awesome. This is going to go into Glenn Poshin. He brought some awareness to the Children's Tumor Foundation, which we're having a Central Jersey walk Saturday, September 27th, at ctf.org. Awesome. And so, yeah, we're going to contribute and just thank you for doing that. And you guys.